Thanks, Mel. Did you want to kick it off? You're the top of screen for us.
Okay. Joe, can you talk us through the changes? Obviously, Noah's got a back issue. What's the story with Tom and him not playing? And what was Lucan's injury also?
Yeah, Lucan got a stinger and so had a limited range of movement in his shoulder. He's coming right. He did a lot of the training today. Just not the contact, so he's moving pretty well. Tom Wright, he trained outside the team today, but was moving pretty well. His was an ankle injury. He did it in inside the first 10 minutes of the test match, and so he really battled through. Didn't pick up too many high speed meters. Was struggling a little bit, but he fought his way through really well. And Noah, when he was replaced, just before he was replaced, really, he got caught awkwardly and just he's just uncomfortable through his shoulder blades quite high, and is still stiff through there. Again, he ran okay today, but is he's not doing contact at the moment. And if you're playing Argentina and you don't do contact, you'll come second.
Of course, and I guess like James Slipper is going to be a storyline, you know, the opportunity to go level with Greggs. He doesn't like to talk himself up, but what have you discovered, I suppose, since becoming Wallabies coach? What do you make of him as a player and a person?
Yeah, Slips, he doesn't really want to talk at all, certainly not about himself. He's really humble and just gets on with the job. He's massively invested in the Wallabies, and his efforts, no matter where you are or what the requirement is, he's just really keen to do what's best for the team. And I think that kind of stands out whenever I have conversations with him, and he's obviously one of the leaders in the group, so I have conversations with him quite often. He spoke to the boys before the test match last weekend and spoke really well. And because he doesn't speak often, I think the words resonate just a little bit more. He's obviously a proud dad twice over now, and that was a commitment that he had in the early part of last week, so he wasn't involved. But it's great to have him back in the mix this week, and that that big number is looking, pretty promising.
Hey, Joe, the fact that you've had to kind of shuffle your 10 around, does it come at the right time? Is it an awkward time? Because Noah had just started to build a bit of that continuity, started to take the game on a bit. Like, is it frustrating to lose him now?
Not really, because we're still trying to build our way forward, and I think it's just, it's a great opportunity for Ben Donaldson. He was the incumbent really from the World Cup, and it's a great opportunity for Tom Liner after having a hamstring niggle that he was struggling to get rid of. He's now 100%, and so those two, they're excited to take on the mantle. And Noah, while he's disappointed, if you'd seen him at training and before training, they're discussing, the strategy around the game for us. He's absolutely bought into being a squad member and trying to help the others prepare.
And consistency has been something that's plagued Australian rugby for quite a while now. What have you found the most difficult thing around getting a young Wallabies group going? And have you noticed anything between weeks around their preparation, or are you confident that they'll be able to maintain the heights of last week and go more?
Yeah, there are parts of last week that weren't really great heights for us. Kickoff reception, high ball reception, high ball on the chase, and we still know that there are elements of our game that need to be better. But there were some elements I thought were really impressive. I really liked the way we built to that second try. There's a number of aspects of how I would like to play involved in that, with a lot of movement off the ball, onto the ball, accuracy of passing. speed of the ball, that came together. Now I'm sure, I know Felipe Contepomi very well, Kenny Lynn, they'll be making sure that their Pumas try to get in the way of that. They've got some guys who slow the ball, attack the ball on the ground really, really strongly, obviously with Montoya. Massive day for him, having his 100th test match for Los Pumas. So they'll be massively motivated. And Matira over the ball, Gonzalez is such a good athlete. And even guys like Sclavi, I've seen get over the ball, and he's very hard to shift once he is over it. So, I think that our continuity in game, in play, is going to be really important, and it's going to be challenging. The conditions are going to be very different. 4 o'clock kickoff, it'll be light throughout the fixture, and it'll be hot. Predicted high of about 28 degrees. It was about 8 degrees last Saturday. Seriously speaking, it was, and it was probably felt colder than that because of the wind and rain. So, 20 degree swing, and hopefully the result doesn't swing.
Hey Joe, I'm sure you've probably seen the reports coming out of South Africa about the Springboks apparently asking World Rugby to look into the Wallabies injuries from that Perth match. Are you able to, just explain those series of injuries and what happened with use of the bench in that match, and just a general response to that? I know Alan obviously spoke yesterday, adamant that clearly the team wants to scrum and not showing away from that.
Yeah, I think that was pretty evident against Los Pumas. I thought the scrum was one of our strong points in the game, and it gave us a couple of access points that were sorely needed in the game. Angus Bell came off both for blood and an injury, and so once you have substituted a player for injury, they cannot return to the field of play. You can substitute them and a front row player can return to the field of play, or any player can return for blood or a head injury. And then we had two head injuries that were assessed by an independent medical doctor, who I'm sure wouldn't appreciate anyone questioning their independence, because for us, in the end, I think in the game we conceded 3 maul tries. We didn't have our big men to combat those mauls. So it's not like anything that we wanted to have happen, but player welfare is paramount. And when players are injured, particularly those two head injuries we got in the second half, it's really important that the protocols for head injury assessments are followed. They both failed their HIA 2 and their HIA 3 as well. So as far as I know, there has been no formal inquiry made to World Rugby. Certainly nothing that World Rugby have come back to us with, and nothing that they have said that they felt was untoward.
Yeah, so you haven't been asked to provide medical records or anything by World Rugby or anyone else?
No. As I said, World Rugby, as far as we know, haven't had a formal request to investigate anything that happened. So they haven't certainly come to us, and they haven't questioned anything that happened, because like us, they know the regulations and they're driven to make sure that player welfare is paramount.
Joe, that a Springbok and a former Springbok captain who's played a lot is questioning a rival nation like what they did by saying that tactically it was a decision that the Wallabies would. But it's dangerous territory, isn't it?
Well, it's someone's prerogative if that's what they believe. We all question things from afar at times, and particularly when we're not abreast of the valid information, but the information is black and white. There was a clear injury in the first half to Angus Bell. He was removed at half time, and the two head injuries in the second half. It's in coaching over 100 test matches that I've never had that happen before. It's not like it happens very often, but we were certainly disadvantaged by it because we didn't get the opportunity to have our big men combating them all. And there were three more tries in the second half, and in the end that caused the scoreboard separation that existed at the end of the game.
Well, on current topics, new week of competition to replace the rugby championship, perhaps, with a tour between the Springboks and the All Blacks. I just wonder what your thoughts are on that, and it may be superseding the rugby championship, whether there's fears that, you know, in a way we're becoming like a second-class nation in terms of that group of four, and whether you think it's a good thing and what Australia might look to explore to do in response.
Yeah, it's a tough question, Tony, because it's a real mix, World Rugby at the moment, with the different competitions and agreements that exist. Six Nations is such a solidified competition that the Northern Hemisphere have a very exclusive club there. And I know talking to the Georgian coaches, they'd love to have a crack at getting into that competition. At the same time, it's not going to replace the Rugby Championship. The Rugby Championship, as far as I know, is going to continue, but it will be truncated in that year. There's also a fair bit of planning and preparation around a Nations Cup that is, I think, potentially a fantastic competition that may be biannual, and it may be that the teams from the Southern Hemisphere accumulate points versus the Northern Hemisphere accumulate points, and you get crossovers and you end up with a championship during the November series. So that's another potential outcome that could really, I think, energise interest in the game.
But do you feel it's a sign that the Rugby Championship in some sense needs fixing, that it's not quite right? Or do you feel as a competition as it stands this season that it works and that it's worth fighting and persisting with?
Well, we had great crowds for two games. You know, I think a total of about 110,000 people came to two games in Australia. It was sold out in La Plata. I'm not sure everyone took their seat because I haven't seen games played in storms like that very often, but you know, they're expecting a bumper crowd here in Santa Fe as well on Saturday. So I think local interest is still really high, and so you would expect that in itself is evidence that the competition still holds some sway with rugby fans.
Just one more while I'm here. Josh Cannon wasn't in, I think, your first squad of the season, and it surprised a few people. Can you describe what he was sent away perhaps to work on, what you've seen since then, and why he's received a call up now?
Yeah, again, Josh is a good athlete, and I think he's a really promising young player. He has gone away and put some work in, and some of that is just the physical grind of trying to make sure that he's prepared for Test match rugby. I think you've got to get the balance right in having people ready for Test match rugby. If you put them in and they're not physically prepared for it, then I think to a degree you set them up to fail, and you set the team up to be a little bit vulnerable. So he's built a bit of confidence through that work he's done, and we've built a bit of confidence in what Josh can deliver. He's a skillful young man. He's a competitor, and we're looking forward to seeing how he copes in a fairly hostile environment on Saturday.
Can I just ask one quickly, Joe, about Max Jorgensen? Obviously, getting a start this week, young man. Some say he's kind of got an old head on young shoulders. What have you made of him, and gave you the confidence to give him a start here?
Yeah, Max has built his way in. He's had a couple of runs off the bench, which is ideal for him to gain a bit of confidence, and for us to know a little bit more about him. I think when he picked that ball up in space from the cross kick from Tom Wright and accelerated, you know, it's not very often that Mapimpi is left grasping, and that's acceleration and footwork that he's got. You know, he didn't quite hold on to a ball that was promising from Noah in the weekend up the right-hand touch, but got some great pressure on the kicker, which allowed us to have a line out on or around the 22, which is where we launched the last attack from that ultimately gave us the opportunity to win the game. So Max, he's working really well off the ball, which was part of what we wanted him to work on. Because once he's on the ball, he's an exciting young rugby player.
Last couple, please, guys.
Joe, just in terms of momentum, All Blacks to follow, you know, how significant are week victories leading into a Bledisloe series?
I'm not sure really. They're a very different opposition, and it will be a different week of preparation for them. To be brutally honest, we're just trying to stack enough positives week to week. But you know, any progress is never linear, and you'll tend to go up and down in different facets of the game. But we're never confident. But we see some elements of growth in the team, and through the test matches that we've played so far, the six matches. You know, if you'd said a few months ago you'll have four wins, then you know, I think that's a little bit of momentum in itself, and we'll just keep trying to stack good elements of performance together, and hopefully that's enough to get us the result at the end of the day. And we'll take a result in the last minute by 1 point any time that's on offer. I'm not sure my heart will sustain those, but certainly it was a real fillip for us last week to get the result.
I might have one more if we have time. Len's coming up next, Joe. So his match last week, I mean, a lot of people had him as the man of the match in that one, and I wonder if you'd seen him play better, what you make of what he's doing currently for you, and just an overall impression of his play in your time here.
Yeah, I thought Len was super. Obviously, he had a clear hand in both the tries. There's no look pass to Tom Wright when he fixed the defenders, drew the defenders to him, gave Tom an opportunity, and then again he made the line break, got the offload to Marika Corombetti, and that was really the momentum leading up to the second try. So, you know, it wasn't just then. He gave us some good advantage line carries. His footwork was really strong, and he connected really well defensively. He's just starting to talk a little bit, Len. He's pretty quiet, an understated character. He's a humble man, and he just gets out there and plays, and we're trying to grow a little bit, because he's got a little bit of experience. You know, he's in there with a guy, Hamish Stewart, who was having his debut, and we're trying to get him to talk a bit with Hamish. They get on really well, but neither of them are really big talkers. They're just doers, and you know, it would be good if they shared what they're doing with each other sometimes, and with others in the team. So that's probably a work on for Len, but his contribution was, it was a bit of a game changer for us, and if there was to be a man of the match, I've no doubt that he would have been in the very short list.